Welcome to our inaugural episode of Behind the Shield, a new interview series that we'll be running this summer that's designed to take you behind the scenes of the Spartan Athletic program. We're going to visit with coaches, administrators, and student athletes as we find out what makes them tick and really the behind the scenes of York College athletics. Our first interviewee will be Matt Day. Matt's a longtime Spartan. He was an All-American baseball player for the Green and White as our starting shortstop for 4 years and now has come back. He worked in campus recreation and now is our associate athletic director. So after this commercial break, we'll bring you associate athletic director Matt Day.
The results are in, and it's clear that our Spartan family really showed their love for York College this YCP Day of Giving. You played an integral role in helping us reach new heights. Thank you for your generosity. Gifts from donors like you make a difference in the lives of our students every single day. Your continued support is so important. Because YCP is a nonprofit, so much of the York College experience is a direct result of the generosity of our donors. This year's Day of Giving created opportunities for every current and future student by providing funding for scholarships, academic areas, and student life that tuition alone cannot cover. Thank you to the entire Spartan family, alumni, current students, parents, and friends of the college. We couldn't have done it without you.
Welcome back to segment two. Joining us, Matt Day. Matt, thanks for taking time out of your day to join us.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
First, let's talk a little bit about your history at York. You're a former baseball player here. Obviously enjoyed your time here enough to come back. Tell us your story about how you came to York in the first place.
Man, that was a long time ago.
Tell me about it.
Paul Saikia, who was Coach Saikia at the time, recruited me out of high school. I was fairly late in the recruiting process. I actually remember playing in a July 4th tournament after my senior year in high school and still hadn't decided where I was going. Coach Saikia had been down to see me play a couple of times. I made my visit Memorial Day weekend, I believe it was, that Monday. Nobody was on campus, but had a really good time. Meeting with, you know, Coach Saikia reminded me a lot of my high school coach, you know, kind of fell in love with the place, what he had to say. And then I guess from there, it's been history.
Nowadays, people might freak out if they didn't have their college decision made. You were so late. Was that a point of stress for you? Or, you know, is that just kind of part of the process and the way it worked out?
I think for me, it was part of the process. My parents, on the other hand, they may have been a little freaked out. You know, I had some other, you know, offers, but it just wasn't, they didn't have the right major that I wanted. Wilmington University, I'm from Wilmington, Delaware. They had given me an offer. They were just going to go Division II, but I wanted to get out of Delaware and kind of get away, not too far away, but, you know, away a little bit. So I don't remember being too freaked out about it. I knew it was, you know, it was all going to play out the way it should. But yeah, a little
bit. It worked out pretty well. Talk a little bit about your title now. You're in the associate athletic director with the Spartans, and talk about your day-to-day things. Normally, obviously, COVID-19's made things a little kind of crazy for you, but talk about what your normal job activities are.
So I think the biggest thing with me is just the relationships with the coaches, you know, being able to build those on a day-to-day basis. But as far as my responsibilities go, helping our coaches with recruiting, I'm the liaison with our admissions department, really the liaison for a number of different departments across campus, kind of in terms of internal operations, housing with over breaks and residence life, getting registration for, you know, open houses and accepted students days and, you know, all of that. Compliance is a big part of my responsibility, so I'm our main compliance officer. Doing some education on our coaches with that. We're checking on kids' eligibility. I help Coach Boslow, our golf coach. I help him advise SAC. That's been, you know, a pretty big undertaking this year. And then a lot of just kind of miscellaneous day-to-day operations, making sure the TVs in the Grumbacher are updated with our game day announcements, our Superfan app, all of those, you know, different things. And then just administratively helping with hiring, long range planning in the department, kind of all the day-to-day stuff.
So you just do a couple things. I mean,
just a couple things.
Just a couple things.
Try to stay busy.
One thing you talked about that I'd really like to kind of branch off with real quick, the Student Athlete Advisory Council. You guys kind of reformatted that this year. Talk about that and that effect on and the benefit to our student athletes.
So with SAC, we've never really had a good model for it, I would say, up until recently. It's kind of always, we want representation from each team. You know, I can kind of see it happening. Who wants to be our SAC? Oh, I'll be our SAC person, you know, and didn't have great attendance at meetings. And really, they were almost like our good deed doers. It came down to we were doing stuff with community service, which is great. But that's ultimately not the main purpose of SAC. The main purpose is so the student athletes have a voice to help that student athlete experience. So we revamped it this summer, this past summer, and started out this year where we got basically nominations from coaches of who they thought would be their best SAC person, whether it was somebody that was the best player on the team, just somebody that, you know, was a role player on the team, whatever it was, whoever would be their best person. And it's really worked out well. You know, obviously we'll have some changes coming up as we just kind of feel our way through the first year. But they've done, you know, some great things. They just kind of took over the SAC Instagram account and did D3 week. You know, they have typically our big thing at the end of the year is Special Olympics, you know, with the COVID-19 that was canceled, but did a theme game for men's basketball, our tropical night, had some plans to do some other ones in the spring so we can market some of those teams. You know, obviously that didn't work out, but at least for the first year, kind of got the things up and rolling, had a SAC representative come to the NCAA convention with us. You know, so I think we're on the right track to make it better and actually enhance the student athlete experience and make it worthwhile for our student athletes.
How important is it for you to have our kids have a voice, to have our kids feel like they have an investment in what we're trying to do for them? How important is that?
I think it's huge. You know, especially when you look at our events, our student athletes are the biggest supporters of our student athletes, which is awesome. That's one of the things I love seeing at our games. But when we try to do, you know, our different tailgates or, you know, just speakers that we bring in for our student athletes, typically, you know, at the end of the year, we've done a giveaway, you know, like a takeaway from our student athletes at the end of the year ceremony. You know, we get to a point sometimes where it's like, we're just a little bit removed from their age. Like, I don't really know what they want. So it's good to have them just kind of give some feedback on when we have tailgates, you know, do we want chicken fingers? Do we want to branch out? Do we want to try to do games at halftime? Do we not? So it's been really good in that help, in that aspect of giving them a voice in terms of that. And I think as we move along and develop, you know, I know a number of years ago, they helped with, change in the dining hall hours. You know, student athletes were getting done practice, but the dining hall was closed. So getting those expanded, some things across campus like that, not that we want to go looking for those things, but if there are areas,
you want to be able to fix things that aren't right.
And they're in it day to day. And if it's not brought to my attention, it might not be something that I never think about.
Right.
You know, so giving them a voice in that aspect, I think is huge.
One thing that you touched on with the attendance of student athletes supporting student athletes, I think that kind of goes hand in hand with the culture that has happened within the coaching ranks and the, mm-hmm. and the office suite. Talk a little bit about how important that has become with, you know, and I think it started changing when we moved to the Grumbacher and we're all in one place or all in one, mm-hmm. you know, essentially one suite, but certainly, Paul has encouraged that as well. Talk about the culture that we have and are very fortunate to have, in my opinion, within our coaching ranks.
I actually think it gets to a point where we take it for granted how good it is. Our coaches feed off each other just at an exceptional rate. And they are always in each other's offices. And, you know, absolutely, it's, you know, how are the kids and how's, you know, the family doing and those types of things. But it is not uncommon to have two coaches in an office talking about, hey, I issue trying to get this group to commit. What are some strategies you use? You know, Coach Hunter and Coach Whitman, you know, maybe talking about X's and O's, or Coach Hunter talking with Coach Childs about things that they do on offense and defense that may help on the basketball framework, just the constant feeding of off of each other. And it shows when you look at our games, they're out supporting each other. Our coaches are at each other's games because of that. Our student athletes are at each other's games. You know, even now, you know, when we get together on a department Zoom call or I'm texting back and forth with a coach, it's awesome to hear that they're also staying in contact with each other about, you know, various things work related and not work related. You know, I think, like I said, I think it's something we kind of take for granted, because my guess is it's probably not the norm. And I've heard stories where I know it's not the norm at some places. And just being able to be around that every single day and being away from it for, I'm looking at the date here, whatever it is, four weeks now, five weeks, like forever. It's something I miss tremendously. And I've told people, I thought one of the things I was going to miss the most was just the routine. It's by far the people, being around our coaches, being around our student athletes. It's made me really appreciate what we have on a day-to-day basis.
No, it's very interesting that you say that, because I've had people who work in my position at other institutions are like, you like your coaches? I'm like, yeah, I love our coaches. I mean, we have amazing people. You know, the one thing that I think we've done an awesome job of is we've hired really good people and people who fit in with the culture and really bring something different to each one of them does. And I just think that's an awesome thing to have happen. So let's tie in. Oh, go ahead.
If I could touch that, I think what you said is we've hired really good people.
Yeah.
You know, and they've been able to win.
Right.
But if you ask them, winning isn't their top priority. They want to win just as much as anybody. Don't get me wrong.
We've got some competitive coaches. There's no doubt. Absolutely.
But their main priority is developing good people. And because of that, they recruit the right kids. Our GPA has skyrocketed. And not only has our GPA gone up, our winning percentage continues to go up. And it's just because we have good people in the right position and they just feed off of each other. And, you know, success kind of breeds success.
There's no question. And I think they push each other. I think there's a friendly competition to, I mean, all of our coaches want to see all of our teams do well. But you know, there's a little bit of friendly competitive banter that goes back and forth and it's a lot of fun to see in the coaching staff. And you know, our kids feed off of that, and our kids know, you know, our coaches have told our kids, hey, it's important to go out and support your fellow student athletes. And, you know, by far our best fans are the kids who are student athletes who come out and cheer their friends on, which I think is critically important.
And Danny, super fan Danny.
Super fan Dan. That's right. No, I feel kind of bad for Dan. I'm not sure what he's doing during this downtime, because they're, you know, he spends a lot of time at the Grumbacher Center.
And yes, he does.
We love having him there. You kind of touched on it a little bit with the COVID-19. You know, I couldn't agree with you more. I think, you know, I miss the games. I miss the kind of the competitive juices that get going. You know, my routine's been completely – actually, I don't have a routine right now, which is kind of weird for me, first time in 25 years. But talk about how this has affected you personally. You know, what's it like being home with the kids? Are they sick of dad yet? And, you know, and how that's kind of affected you professionally as well.
Yeah, no, I think it's made me kind of step back. I'll kind of take it from a personal level first. It's made me step back and appreciate the time. You know, the first couple of days I was really bummed that I wasn't at work and, you know, still kind of having that. I'll call it hangover from the cancellation of spring seasons. The heartbreak for those student athletes, particularly our seniors, but all of our spring student athletes. you know, they all work so hard. So I was kind of having kind of that little bit of hangover, but really just kind of tried to shift my perspective and appreciate the time that I'm getting to spend with, you know, my wife and my kids is, it's awesome. If we were in the middle of the spring season, we wouldn't be getting to spend this time together, because on top of our workload, I'd be, you know, two or three nights a week, and Saturdays we'd be scarfing dinner down or meeting them at practice for my son. And, you know, instead what we're doing is after dinner, we've been able to go on family walks, you know, play wiffle ball in the backyard.
I was gonna say, is that wiffle ball field set up in the backyard?
And I don't have it lined, but yeah, okay. Plenty of wiffle ball in the backyard. But just kind of spend that time together. And, I think the other thing personally is I'm a person of faith, and it has made me rely on that hope that I have, and just try to have as much positive outlook as possible. There's a lot of unknowns, every day. You know, there's more unknowns that come up every day. Instead of getting closer to answers, I think there comes more question marks at times. So just kind of being able to have that hope, that positive aspect, from a personal level. Professionally, as I mentioned, it's allowed me to do some things that I haven't kind of been able to get to, some research and some projects that
there's a lot of that, isn't
tackle.
It? Yeah.
That if we were in the middle of the spring season, it'd be like, we can get to that in the summer.
Yeah.
Then the summer comes and goes and you never really get to it. But I think going back to just not taking for granted what we have with the staff that we have, it's really allowed me to kind of reflect on that. And then also, how can we take this opportunity and use it to grow? That's kind of been on my mind a lot, of how do we shift and change from an institution standpoint, from a department standpoint, and use this to catapult us to the next level, as opposed to figuring out how not to set us back, trying to look at it more as a catalyst.
Well, I think talking about that growth mindset is really the key to everything. You know, we can, mm-hmm. we can come back after this and be where we were at, or we could be worse, or we could grow and figure out a way to continue to get better. You know, I think mm-hmm. one of the things that has been during this entire process that's been good is I feel like we've reconnected people through technology to be able to do, you know, like what we're doing right now. Who knew that we could do so much stuff with electronically? And obviously it's no substitute for being right next to somebody, but you don't feel quite so alone because you can reach out and connect with people. And, you know, I've heard you talk about how important that is. And, you know, that's certainly significant, I think, for our department. I think it's significant for people. You know, my biggest worry is people who don't have people to reach out to, how hard that is for them to go through that right now. So I think we're certainly very fortunate. One other point I'd like to touch on, we're getting ready to move to the MAC July 1st. Obviously a huge deal for York College Athletics and York College in general. What are some of the benefits you feel like that moving to the MAC will bring to the Spartans?
To me, I think one of the things I'm most excited about is there's the obvious, there's going to be some less travel, you know, less missed class time, you know, some of the obvious things. But one of the things I'm most excited about is the potential for some true rivalries. Mm-hmm. You know, we have Stevenson that's 45 minutes away, Messiah that's 45 minutes away. You know, that gives our fans the ability to go to away games. You know, if our men's soccer team is playing Messiah or our women's soccer team is playing Messiah at 7 o'clock on a Wednesday night, it's not out of the question for some of our students to drive there to support them. And I think as we start to form some of those, that's, I think, what I'm most excited about and how that can enhance the student athlete experience from a, you know, home field, home court advantage, that student athlete support, getting them to go to away games, which, you know, very few people are
driving
to Newport.
No.
You know, and I think some of those, if those opponents were closer in the CAC, they absolutely could have happened. Mm-hmm. But it's, you know, just a logistics standpoint. I think that's one of the things I'm most excited to see how that takes off and progresses.
Well, and I think we don't have – well, who's our rival right now? If you named one person, if you named a conference school, who would it be? There's no really good rivalry where it's close enough where it becomes an event. You know, I think one of the things – if you looked at our men's soccer game against Masaya this year, the stands were packed. You know, there were a lot of Masaya people there, and because it's an easy trip to make. You know, I think that's something you'll start seeing reflecting in our attendance numbers. And just you talked about student-athlete experience. Who doesn't want to play in front of a crowd that's all charged up and ready to go? I mean, that's what we want for our kids. And I think this move to the MAC has really given us that possibility. And the fact that, you know, the travel is going to be a lot better. We're competing against more like schools, which I think is really a big thing for us. So that's really important. Well, Matt, thanks for taking a time out of your day to join us. We're certainly really excited to get this off the ground. And, you know, we figured we put you out front and let you carry the first episode. So
thanks. Yeah. Put the weight on my shoulders.
You're ready to do that. You're a big guy. Yeah. So thanks for taking the time to join us. We're super excited about that. And thanks for joining us. We'd like to thank Matt Day for joining us for our inaugural broadcast of Behind the Shield. We hope you enjoyed it and look forward to joining us again. Our next episode will feature head volleyball coach Dan Mickle. So join us again as we will post this on YouTube, on the Spartan YouTube channel, and we will also post it on the athletic website at ycpspartans.com. Until next time, have a great day and go Spartans.